Welcome back students. In the previous lecture we have seen tension quotient method for analysis of trusses. What we learned is it is a very neat and simple method for analysis of trusses, and it is easily extendable to analysis of space trusses. So it is important to have an introduction to space trusses before we do the actual analysis. So in this lecture we are going to have an introduction to space trusses, then we learn the indeterminacy and stability condition for space trusses, and most importantly we learn how to identify zero member forces. Space trusses are axial members which are pin jointed together to form a stable three-dimensional structures. So the members will be having only axial forces here, either compression or tension. The simplest form of a space truss is a tetrahedron, which is having 1, 2, 3, 4 joints and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 6 members. So this is the simplest form of a space truss. Okay. So you can move to complex space truss by adding joints and elements to members to this simple truss. So basically we start with the tetrahedron, and again we'll add some joints and some members, go for a complex structures. Even we can go for some compound structures where two complex trusses will be joined together. Now let's discuss about stability and determinacy conditions for space truss. So it is important to note that at every joint of space truss there are three equations of equilibrium, which is sigma fx equal to 0, sigma fy equal to 0, and sigma fz equal to 0. And the external stability of the truss depends upon the support reaction. The support reaction should be such that it is able to satisfy all the force and moment equilibrium. So for the general loading, the available force and moment equations are sigma fx equal to 0, sigma fy equal to 0, sigma fz equal to 0, and similarly moment about z, moment about y, and moment about z is equal to 0. So in that case we can say that we require at least 6 support reaction to maintain the space truss at a stable position. Okay, so which means that, so if the number of reaction is less than 6, the space truss is unstable, and if it is greater than 6, it is externally indeterminate. In that case we can say that external indeterminacy of space truss is r minus 6, where r is the number of reactions or supports. Now let's talk about the internal indeterminacy. Let's start with the simplest perfect truss, which is nothing but a basic tetrahedron. So if you consider a joint outside of this somewhere to make this truss complex, for this particular thing a member has to be added from P, then another member from C, and another member from D has to be added so that the structure is stable. That means that for each of the new member added, each of the new joint added, we require 3 additional members. With this background, when we start we had only 4 joints and 6 members. So with this background we can write the equation for perfect truss, which is M is equal to 6, which is 6 members are there initially, and for every joint in excess of 4 joints, 1, 2, 3, 4 joints are there. In every joint in excess of 4 joints, we require 3 additional members. So this will make the equation for a perfect truss. So if the number of members is less than 3j minus 6, the truss is stable, and if m is greater than 3j minus 6, the truss is internally indeterminate, which means that there are some extra or redundant members. Which means that the internal intermittency we can write it as m minus 3j plus 6. The external intermittency we already seen, it is r minus 6, where r is a number of reactions. So if we add the internal and external intermittency together, we will get the total internal indeterminacy. So that is going to be m plus r minus 3j. So by looking at the total indeterminacy of the 3D truss or space truss, we can talk about the stability and determinacy together. Suppose say m plus r is less than 3j. It means that the truss is statically unstable. If m plus r is 3j equal to 3j, it means that it is a perfect truss and it is statically indeterminate and stable. Statically determinate and stable. If m plus r is greater than 3j, we can say that it is stable but it is indeterminate. Now let's see the different types of supports used in space truss. The first type is a short link. By short link, I mean it is an external member which is supporting a joint. So the resultant at this joint will be directed along the member. The second type of supports is what we call as bolt or roller. So bolt or roller is something which restrains the motion perpendicular to the plane, which means that it is this particular joint is free to move horizontally in x direction as well as in the y direction. However, the vertical moment is restrained, which means that there is a vertical reaction. The next one is slotted roller constraint in a cylinder. It basically means that there is a cylinder, maybe half cylinder, open at top, lying along an axis, and inside that we include a roller, which means that the movement is only permissible in one direction, which means that other two directions is restrained, which means that in other two directions there are reactions. The last one is a ball and socket arrangement. It is just like a hinge actually. So there is a fixed socket here, and inside that we included a ball, which means that ball is not able to move in any of the direction. So when ball is not allowed to move in any of the three direction, the reaction will be there in all the three direction. So this is the description for the types of supports used in space truss. Now let's see one of the most important aspect we have to learn when we are analyzing space truss. So space truss, we basically have complicated arrangement and there are so much of members. So it is important that we identify initially those members in which the member forces are zero, so that the complexity of the problem can be reduced. So for that, in order to identify the zero force members, there are some theorems. So the first theorem states that if all the members and external force except one member lies in the same plane, then the force in the member which was out of plane is zero. Which means that let's consider this joint P. At joint B, there is a force P acting. Then there is this horizontal member, this horizontal member as well, and a vertical member which is called as A. So you can see that the joint P, the force in the this horizontal member and this horizontal member, everything acts in the xy plane. However, the member B A is perpendicular to the xy plane, which means that this member force is going to be zero. Second theorem says that if all the members at the joint has zero force except the last two members and both the members do not lie in the straight line, then the member force in those two last members is also zero. So let's take this example here. So here there are five members meeting at this joint. So initially, and already we know that this member and this member are zero force members. The remaining, there are two members, and we know that on both these members are not lying in the same straight line. which means that this remaining two members is also going to be zero force members. Now let's see the third theorem. So here, if you notice, there are three members meeting at this joint, and all these three members are not lying in any of the common plane, and there is no external load acting at this particular joint. So in this case, we can say that the member force in each of these members is going to be zero. Now let's see an example to identify the zero member forces. So here we have a complex space stress given in the question. So there are so many connections and two levels are there. So the task is to identify the zero member forces. So we notice that loading is given only at joints H and G. Okay. E and F is unloaded. So let's start with the joint F. And at the joint F, if you notice this trapezium EFCD lies in a single plane. Okay. The total forces in this particular joint F is actually force in FE, force in FP, force in FC, and force in GF. Okay, so you can see that all these forces EF, FD, and FC are lying in a single plane, and the force FG is out of plane, which means that according to theorem 1, the force FG is going to be 0. Okay. Again, if you take joint F, you can see that there is no external load acting on the joint F. So by theorem, and all these are not in the same plane. Okay. So according to theorem 3rd, you can say that the member forces EF, DF, CF is also going to be 0. For the same reason, if you take the joint E also, there is no external loading acting at E, and hence all the member forces meeting at E is going to be 0 member forces, that is EH, EA, and ED is also going to be 0 member forces. Now this concept has helped us to remove so much of member forces from the problem, and thereby simplifying the problem. So that's it for today's lecture. In the next lecture, we'll see the analysis of a space stress using the tension quotient method. Thank you.